We're here on a 33 square tear-off re-roof job where they're installing a CertainTeed integrity roof system. They're laying down winter guard, putting in swift start starters, roofer select underlayment, landmark shingles, and shadow ridge caps. As you can see, this house has a few dormers and a stone chimney, critical areas for flashing. The chimney foundation is usually separate from the main house foundation so that the chimney can move independently. That's why the base flashing is secured to the roof deck and the counter flashing or cap flashing is secured to the chimney. So now if the chimney moves, the flashing acts as a movable joint. Flashing around dormer walls is another important area. You have to put base flashing at the point where the dormer meets the sloping roof, and then you're step flashing up the sidewalls. Now on this job, they've got a porch roof, which is a lower slope roof. They put winter guard over the entire deck. On roof slopes below 412 down to 212, we require winter guard, or its equivalent.
We all know that shingles don't leak, but flashing does. Most often we find leaks at penetration points such as skylights, chimneys, sidewalls, step flashing, those kinds of places.
There's several different types of flashing. Drip edge is the most basic.
Drip edge is used at the rake to prevent wind-driven rain from getting beneath the underlayment. Along the eaves, it allows the water to run off the roof smoothly.
Obviously, you have to wrap edgings around the perimeter and, more importantly, on the fascia. A standard C3.5 drip edging just doesn't fit into the gutter. So we use a larger size edging to the gutter so that we don't get the water falling behind and actually damaging soffits, damaging fascia boards, causing more damage for the homeowners in the future.
Now let's talk about step flashing. There's four things to know about step flashing. First, never fasten the cap flashing to the roof deck or to the step flashing. Those two pieces have to move independently. Don't nail the strip to the wall. That allows it to float or move with the deck. Each metal step flashing piece has to overlap the next piece by at least 2 inches. The height of your step flashing must be at least 2 inches high. Higher is better, especially in snow country. And fourth, as a general rule of thumb, the length of your step flashing should be 2 inches more than the shingle exposure. You can refer to the SAM for each individual shingle product, which will give you the minimum dimensions for length and height. When applying winter guard as a valley liner, you start your application at the low point and work up. Be sure you get good adhesion down in the valley center line. If you have to tack your winter guard because of cold weather, make sure you don't put any fasteners closer than 6 inches to the valley center line. For close cut valleys, the shingles on one roof area are extended at least 12 inches onto the adjoining roof area. Open valleys are recommended for our thicker shingles.
We truly, truly believe in open valley structure. You know, we like to put the shingles in and do a cut, but on a higher end product that we know it's going to last 30 to 40 years, we want to go ahead and put an open valley system in. By using an open valley, we know the water is going to drain properly. It's going to be on metal, preferably copper.
What we do is we install the shingles up the valley area with leaving a 3-inch gap, and we also do what's called a dog ear, which, so at the top of the shingle, we cut an angle backwards so that the water doesn't drip inside the valley area, and when it hits it, it diverts it out into the center of the valley, not back into the inside part of the valley where we can get leaking.
Well, on this we did a floating copper metal valley on the details. So we put it, lined the valley with ice and water shield, put in rosin paper so that the copper doesn't stick to the ice and water shield, and then we put in a floating cleated with returns on it, a copper valley. So it has returns and cleats holding those returns. So it's a floating valley, no nails in that metal. The cleats are holding the valley on.
You can refer to the SAM to see what is recommended or required for each shingle product. For top of the line shingles, we recommend using at least 16 ounce copper or its equivalent. In the manual, there's a chart that lists copper equivalents. On woven valleys, your shingles from the intersecting roof areas extend across the valleys. Succeeding courses alternate up the valley and you don't trim the edges.
So we've cut into the stonework here and made a reglet cut, prepared it for counter flashing that we're going to install. A lot of guys on a stone job like this would probably put in an aluminum K flashing, which is a caulk dependent flashing. So we're going after a riglet cut counter flashing that is cut into the wall. And then we cut that groove, then we bend back and put a return on the metalwork and insert it into that that cut. So we fill the cut with caulk. So we're backfilling it with caulk, bending that piece of metal in there and putting it in the return just like the manual says to do for a CertainTeed installation. And then we take small strips of lead and jam it into that return inside there so that that counterflashing doesn't back out. And then we fill it with caulk and put in a lifetime sealant. So that's a riglet cut counterflashing.
One key thing that we truly believe in is, you know, your standard pipe collar. We use an aluminum style with, you know, the rubber gasket. But we believe in a once and done job. You know, the materials that we use are high quality, so we want to make sure that we provide the best possible for them. So what we do is we actually install the regular pipe collar over top of your standard pipe, cut it out for the size, and we take another small pipe collar like this, just to retrofit. And go right over top. And what that does is create a little bit more of a weather-tight seal, and it creates protection underneath from sun exposure so that we don't have any problems with that.